All right, so we again start from brief reminder about the end of previous lecture. So we introduced formalism for quantum mechanics, and it's essentially the theory of self-adjoint operators in a Hilbert space. So a state of a physical system is associated to a vector with a unit norm in a Hilbert space, and observable, something which you can measure, is presented by a self-adjoint operator on this Hilbert space, and expression for the average value of observable, so expectation value, would be given by such a product, in a product of action A on F, and when in a product with the vector phi. So, and having the expectation, we also may define the dispersion of an observable, which measure how far is possible value of measurement from the average, which from the expectation value, which is given by the previous expression. When we have introduced the Schrodinger model, in this Schrodinger model, coordinates are measured by operator, unbounded operator on the Hilbert space L2, which is provided by the multiplication with the component Q. So we multiply by the value of coordinate, integrate our state with corresponding values, and measure the corresponding values. Similarly, the momentum observable will be given by the derivative as a generator of a shift. So momentum produce dynamic uniform, according to Galileo principle, it's the uniform motion with constant velocity. So that is shift translations, which generated by derivative. And commutators between operator of coordinate and momentum will be, of course, given by the Heisenberg commutator relation. So this is a quantum mechanical interpretation. The same of formalism can be considered for the signal processing. For the signal processing, here we have different names, just names for the same mathematical objects, and the coordinate operator, coordinate picture, correspond to the time of a inside the signal, and momentum will be an observable which correspond to the frequency of a signal. So the signal characterized by certain frequencies at certain moments of time. And here again, there is a connection with the de Broglie waves. So quantum mechanical systems can be also modeled by certain wave associated to the particles. So here again, signal picture give just an additional depth to the quantum mechanical description of the that model. Here we came to the demonstration of a rather important property, which is known as uncertainty relation. So roughly in mathematical term, that uncertainty relation means that we cannot localize well a function and its Fourier transform simultaneously. If we will make a function well localized, that means it shall avoid the support, shall be in some small compact set, then the Fourier transform frequencies of corresponding signal shall be unbounded. So it appears frequencies of arbitrary high pitches. And similarly, in quantum mechanical language, it will be discussed later. But let us see how we may demonstrate that property. So here we have the two operators A and B, self-adjoint operator on a Hilbert space H. When we have this inequality 68, which can be stated for arbitrary self-adjoint operator and arbitrary real numbers A and B. And it's tell that the norms of product of norms for on particular state U will be not less than a half of the commutator of F AB A and B on the corresponding state U. So there is an important addition to this inequality. We will note what that inequality turns into identity exactly if A and B are linearly dependent on U. So they annihilate U, linear combination of A and B annihilate U for a particular real number R in that expression which is shown. The proof is very straightforward. We start to expand the right-hand side of our inequality 68 in usual algebraic term using bilinearity of the inner product. And when we arrive to the conclusion what that right-hand side is equal to the expression given in identity 69. And when this is just a product, inner product of two vectors, and we may use Cauchy-Schwarz inequality to state what inner product of these two vectors is bounded by the product of their norm. So that gives exactly identity inequality 68. And again, it's known what Cauchy inequality became identity just in the case when vectors are linearly dependent. So we here just evaluate the imaginary part of that inner product. So for this reason, coefficient in the linear dependence of this operator on particular state shall be purely imaginary number. So it's I times a real number. So that make a demonstration. So that is rather simple identity which link commutator, which tells what we have that lower estimate for the dispersions in term of the. So I just recall what we have here, the formalism of quantum mechanics and expression which we have estimated here, exactly dispersion of quantum mechanical states. So they are bounded below by the commutator of corresponding operators. In particular, so that previous result was of quite general nature. In particular, we have the coordinate and momentum operators, as we discussed before. And for coordinate and momentum operators, the commutator is always a multiple of identity. So on any vector, action of this commutator will be non-trivial. So because this is an identity operator, there is no kernel for it. So we have that inequality for the dispersion of coordinate and momentum operator in quantum mechanics, which just follow from the previous consideration and the property of commutator in our representation. It's interesting to look what is the particular function which minimizes the uncertainty between coordinate and momentum. And just using the previous relation, the previously we told what it shall be a solution of this identity, so function which minimizes the uncertainty shall solve that inequality. And solving this inequality, this is the first order differential operator, we find the Gaussian. We find what function which is minimize will be Gaussian with a certain parameter. That parameter in quantum mechanics may be interpreted as a particular squeeze, a particular relation between coordinates and momentum, a representation of the Gaussian. But we will not use squeezed states in our course, so this is just a side remark about it. So let us take a closer look on the Gaussian, because it will play a rather serious role in what follow. So we may look on the corresponding coherent states, which will be generated by the Gaussian, taking as a ground state. So that coherent states obtained by action of a Schrodinger representation of the Heisenberg group So it was given is the identity 34. So essentially, we have elements of the Heisenberg group which act by the shift. So if we will take a look on the Gaussian drawn here, so shift is just translate the pike of the Gaussian to corresponding coordinates. And we also have multiplication by the that exponential factor with imaginary value. And multiplication by this exponential factor means shift of frequencies. So that will be the shift in the Fourier transform of our model. So that is shift in the frequencies. And so Gaussian, if we will look on average values of coordinate and momentum, have both values equal to zero. So Gaussian itself represents the ground state, the physical system, which is in the rest and has average value for coordinate and momentum equal to zero. And by action of the Heisenberg group, we obtain respective coherent states with average value of coordinate momentum to be at arbitrary point of the phase space. So we are really produce the corresponding shifts on the phase space, corresponding coherent wavelets and coherent states will be just represented in this way. And then if we will make the covariant transform with this Gaussian, we will arrive exactly to the Fock-Segal-Bargman transform, which was already introduced before. So as you can see, appearance of that expression or taking the Gaussian as mother wavelets in that expression was not an accident. It was motivated by a quantum mechanical model. Just to mention other possibilities, we will describe also other transformation, which will be an extension of our Heisenberg group. We will take the automorphism of Heisenberg group, which is presented by scaling. So if we will consider such a transformation, when it's really a symplectic automorphism, where we make scaling by coefficient A in the coordinate X and 1 over A in the coordinate Y. So that will be that type of squeezed Gaussian, or it's also known as Gabor functions. And then with such squeezed states, we may produce the corresponding covariant transform as well. So an extension, so that will be an extension of the Heisenberg group by this group of symplectic, one parameter group of symplectic automorphism. So it will be subgroup of the Schrodinger group, which we have introduced before, as the semi-direct product of the Heisenberg group and group of its symplectic automorphism. So that will be just one particular subgroup which produce this squeezed states in our circumstances. But again, it's an important tool to consider certain quantum mechanical models, but it's outside of the scope of our course. Next property which we want to consider in connection with the Gaussian and highlight more properties of Fock-Segal-Bargman space will be the relation of right regular representation to wavelet transform. Let me recall what the wavelet transform has very fundamental properties which are widely used and essentially is probably the one most important property which motivate all that construction at all. So covariant transform or wavelet transform which we have considered intertwines the given representation used to construct that wavelet transform with the left regular representation. But what happened, is there any relation to the right regular representation and wavelet transform? So corresponding transformation property is also easy to derive, and it can be given in rather general term of covariant transform, but probably for purposes of this course, it's better to look on this expression related to wavelet transform. So that formula tell us that if we apply a right regular representation to the wavelet transform, we will obtain a wavelet transform with a different mother wavelet. So that will be just transform our mother wavelets by representation rho. And this is most rather interesting and useful property, as we will see now. So we may put here the condition that there is a certain derived representation of our Lie algebra and a certain linear combination made of derived representation would annihilate our mother wavelet. So mother wavelet applied to this affected by this derived representation produce zero. So just by the previous formula, just by previous formula, we immediately see that when if effect on mother wavelet is zero, when entire wavelet transform disappear. That means in this way, generating lead derivatives, which correspond to the right regular representation, we will produce the operator which annihilate the entire image space of the wavelet transform. And in particular, for the our Gaussian, for the vector which satisfy the best possible uncertainty relation, so the minimized uncertainty relation, we have such an operator which will be just m minus I times with certain factor operator of derivative. So that operator annihilate Gaussian, then we will translate this to the image space, to Fock-Segal-Bargman space. All vectors in this image space shall be annihilated by the lead derivatives corresponding to corresponding linear combination of lead derivatives for operator M and D. So calculation of these lead derivatives produce exactly the Cauchy-Riemann operator. So here turn out that the function in Fock-Segal-Bargman space are analytical function of complex variable. That result is rather general, so we may put it in the corresponding form. So that is our discussion, which we had so far, lead to the general conclusion. That all time when we have the minimal value of our uncertainties, we have operators which are satisfy that relation with the corresponding state. So if this state is chosen for the corresponding as mother wavelet for corresponding wavelet transform, then we obtain the space by means of wavelet transform image space consists of functions which satisfy to the Cauchy-Riemann type equation, which may be nevertheless rather different from Cauchy-Riemann equation, but has a similar structure. So uncertainty, minimal value of uncertainty in this way is related with certain analytical properties when we apply wavelet transform using mother wavelets with minimal uncertainty, we always get a kind of analytical condition. So that is interesting relation between two properties which seems unconnected from the beginning. Now we produced quite a lot of different results, and we may use them to study properties of the representations which we built so far. So I recall what by the means of by the means of induced representation, we have constructed various representation of the Heisenberg group. So in particular, Schrodinger representation, Fock-Segal-Bargman representation, and we would like now to analyze this representation in terms of their properties like to be unitary, irreducible, and so forth. Of course, Schrodinger representation is unitary. Here we used the form of the Schrodinger representation, which was obtained by means of Fourier transform. So here, we applied the Fourier transform and Kirilov Fourier transform and transfer the Schrodinger representation to the coadjoint orbit. So here coordinates Q and P are used. So in one dimension, it's just coordinate Q on the configurational space of the quantum system. And the unitarity of this representation is clear because that representation is composition of shift, but shift on the real line is isometry in any LP space. And it's also possible to see what representation by variable y, which result in multiplication with unimodular function which take just complex values with absolute value equal to 1. That is also does not affect L2 norm of this function. So that is, in fact, the unitary representation in L2 space. That representation is also irreducible. There are several forms how to several ways to demonstrate that irreducibility. One of them is to use just the standard definition, what operator representation is irreducible if the only operator commuting with all possible representation will be a multiple of the identity. And it's easy to see what multiplying by this unimodular functions, which is really, if you will look on where real and imaginary part will be cosine and sine functions, so with different oscillation, with different periods. So such functions separate point on the real line. So you always can pick up sine and cosine function such what in one given point it take value 0 and another given point it take value 1. So points are separated, so for our function. And if we have such collection of operators which separate points, then operator which commute with all such operator separating points will be operator of multiplication by a function. But if it's operator of multiplication by a function which commute with all possible shift, then clearly that shall be multiplication with a constant function. Because if you will pick up any non-constant function with two different values, at least two different values, then corresponding shift by the distance between these points where different values are taken will just will not be commuting with this multiplication. So that is a scheme to demonstrate what Schrodinger representation is irreducible. Next. connection with the irreducible with Schrodinger representation will be the role of the Fourier transform in its study. So consider again the symplectomorphism, so denoted here by iota. So it's a symplectic transformation again in xy coordinates, which as we know from the theory, is outer automorphism of the Heisenberg group. So if we will compose a group, automorphism of a group with representation of a group, we will just obtain another representation of a group. So it's a general property which is easy to verify. Indeed, if you have some automorphism alpha of your group, and automorphism means what multiplication of on two elements, so will be just alpha g1 alpha g2, and alpha g is back in your group. And if you have a representation of your group by operators on certain vector space V, then the composition of rho and alpha applied to G is again a representation on this vector space V. As easy to see, just combining the properties of automorphism and the representation. So applying this composition to a product of two elements, we first apply automorphism to the product. So it will be rho alpha g1 alpha g2. When applying the property of the representation, what is again a group homomorphism into algebra of operators, we obtain what this is a representation homomorphism, which we as we say. So composition of this symplectomorphism with the Schrodinger representation can be evaluated directly. So if you take an expression for Schrodinger representation and take that symplectomorphism iota, you will see what the formula which you will obtain will be just again a form of the Schrodinger representation. So when we may look on the operator which intertwine with the Schrodinger representation in one form with the Schrodinger representation composed with automorphism iota, and this turn out what operator intertwining with two representation is exactly the Fourier transform. So Fourier transform has this nice property that it's intertwine Schrodinger representation and Schrodinger representation composed with iota. And we may derive some easy to obtain properties from this observation. In particular, we may see what Schrodinger representation is a unitary operator itself, just to make intertwining property between two unitary representations shall satisfy that relation. We also can immediately see what square of iota make just reversion of signs in x and y, and that means what square of the Fourier transform is reverse sign on functions. So in this way, we calculate inverse to the Fourier transform as a composition of the Fourier transform and reflection of function, which make inversion of signs. So inverse of Fourier transform can be obtained from this observation. So what else about Fourier transform? It's interesting to see what would be the image of the Fourier transform under the image of Gaussian under the Fourier transform. And again, pleasant surprise is what Gaussian is a fixed vector of the Fourier transform. So to see that, we may use again its relation of the Gaussian to the Heisenberg group and its derived representation. I recall that the Gaussian is annihilated by the such differential L operator, D plus IM. And it's easy to see what after under Fourier transform. So essentially, again, coming back to our previous slide, the Fourier transform is swapping X and Y. So because it's built on the base of this symplectic morphism, which swapping X and Y. So when we make such a swap here for derived representation under the Fourier transform operator. So again, coming back. So Fourier transform sending operator M to D, and Fourier transform is sending D to minus M. So Fourier transform would send D plus I M to the operator, which is minus M plus I D, or just placing I outside of the brackets, we get again I M plus D. So as you can compare what we started and ended, so this operator is essentially invariant or multiplied by a factor I under the Fourier transform. So that means that Gaussian after Fourier transform come again to a function which annihilated by the same operator, but this is the first order differential operator, and it has unique solution which is Gaussian up to a scalar. So the matter of calculation of Fourier transform of the Gaussian will be reduced just to calculation of the constant, so which appears under Fourier transform when we apply it to Gaussian, and that constant can be evaluated just based on that fundamental property. So the total integral of the Gaussian over the real line is equal to 1 if Gaussian is properly normalized with the factor pi here. So when total weight, so that is again a fact which has a lot of useful applications, in particular in statistics, and for quantum mechanics it's significant as well, because as you remember, the states in quantum mechanics are described by vectors with the unit norm. So Gaussian is preserved by the Fourier transform, it's a fixed vector, and that allow us to derive unitarity of the Fourier transform. So Fourier transform will be an isometry of L2 space. Well, it's maybe not completely rigorous demonstration here, but we it will provided because it's link the property of Fourier transform, which is a crucial operator for many areas of mathematical analysis and application, with the representation theory of the Heisenberg group. So, as we already said, the Heisenberg group has Schrodinger representation, and Fourier transform just intertwine Schrodinger representation of the Heisenberg group with itself. And Schrodinger representation is irreducible. When intertwining operator of between two irreducible representation or irreducible representation with itself shall be a constant of a multiple of identity, multiple of identity. And so Fourier transform in this sense shall be just an isometry of a vector space to itself, and we need to calculate the multiple of identity which appears in that relation. But to calculate that constant, it will be enough to analyze what happened with just one particular vector. So if operator is multiple of identity, then just any vector tell you what constant is. And for Gaussian, for this vector, again, based on its relation to the Heisenberg group, we already calculate that constant. That constant for Gaussian is one, so Fourier transform is an isometry. And for quantum mechanics, description or significance for quantum mechanics or for signal processing of Fourier transform is as follows. So it's map the configurational space of the system to momentum space. So instead of function which is represented in the Schrodinger model as a function of coordinate by means of Fourier transform, we come to the Hilbert space where a function is represented as a function of variable which is momentum. So that is what happened for quantum mechanics. And for signal, instead of representation in time space, signal as function of time, we came to the representation of signal as function of its frequency. So coming back to other representations, so Schrodinger representation was one representation. Another representation which we built was in Fock-Segal-Bargman transform. Fock-Segal-Bargman space, and we already used Gaussian to calculate the corresponding wavelet transform between two pictures, picture in the coordinate representation, and Fock-Segal-Bargman space can be viewed as space of function defined on the phase space, where we have both coordinates and momentums. And so that representation have appeared several times in our course already. We want here just to make explicit calculation for the action of Heisenberg group on Fock-Segal-Bargman space is derived representation. Again, just in standard way, as the derived representation was defined in our course, we may get identities 80 from 79. And as a check of our calculation, we may once more evaluate the commutator of these vectors, derived representations, which again, the Heisenberg commutator relation. So X and Y commutes, commutator of X and Y produce the central element S. So in this representation, it's again act as multiplication by a scalar. And again, just to finalize our previous consideration, we already said what uncertainty and analyticity are related by wavelet transform. So in our case, if we will calculate what corresponding action of operators are in Fock-Segal-Bargman case, we will get such an operator. So this is derivative with the with respect to complex variable z plus that factor pi z bar. And so if we will take L2 function on the phase space, L2 function of X and Y, and multiply it by such a factor, functional factor, then if F was satisfied 81, then as a result, the product will be the null operator of Cauchy-Riemann operator. So that is what oftenly used in mathematical analysis when Fock-Segal-Bargman space is considered, and it's always oftenly used for convenience in quantum mechanics. So instead of L2 functions with respect to Lebesgue norm on the phase space, researchers consider functions which are square integrable with respect to Gaussian norm. So they take that factor into the corresponding measure. So they consider a measure which is e to the power minus pi modulus z squared. Then multiplication of our L2 function of phase space produce a function which is square integrable with respect to this Gaussian measure. So in this way, we have exactly analytical condition, Cauchy-Riemann operator, but we are paying the price what measure which we integrate is not Lebesgue measure, but that rather Gaussian measure. Okay, so probably that is the right place to stop our lecture today. Questions? Okay, thank you.